nicely. It's a letter from Frank Valeriote, our MP. So I'll read that. Good afternoon. I regret my inability to attend today's event. It is important that the people of Guelph and elsewhere continue to recall the incidents of Election Day 2011. I applaud the efforts of Fair Vote Guelph and the St. James Environment and Social Justice Committee undertaken today. The events of May 2, 2011, in which automated calls were made to Guelph voters directing them to a wrong polling station, were reprehensible and a direct attack on both democracy and the people of Guelph. I recall standing outside the Quebec Street Mall and witnessing voters, many of them elderly, walking away discouraged by the prospect that they could not vote at that location, having made such an effort to attend and deciding to go home rather than vote. The attempt to prevent any person from exercising their democratic right to vote was far more than an impulsive act deployed in Guelph by one person, a sentiment shared by the Federal Court of Canada and the Ontario Court of Justice. We know these calls were calculated and made from coast to coast to coast. Unfortunately, justice will not be brought to others who may have been involved. Of greater significance was the refusal of the federal government to properly arm Elections Canada, who sought the tools needed to prevent, detect, and prosecute those who may choose to engage in such conduct again. We must always remain vigilant and aware that these events could reoccur. Yours sincerely, Frank Valeriote, Member of Parliament for Guelph. And we have some copies of this letter available, particularly for members of the media who would like to quote from this, this document. So I will try to keep us on track. We have a pretty full program here. And we'll start with presentations by four citizens of Guelph who received robocalls, and they will share with us what happened on May 2, 2011.
Issues both in Canada and around the world. And yet, in spite of my skepticism, or some people would call it my cynicism, about politics or my wariness about particular politicians or parties, I didn't question even for a moment when I received an automated message directing me to an alternate polling station. I went straight from work to the Quebec Street Mall, where I was greeted by a sheepish yet very helpful fellow who informed me of my folly. In that moment, I realized that as informed and skeptical as I believed myself to be, I was also embarrassingly naive. I thought that the biggest issue facing elections in Canada was voter apathy, not voter suppression or manipulation. I now firmly believe that I was targeted for this robocall because I had sometime earlier in the campaign, he answered a call where I stated that no, under no uncertain terms would I vote for your party leader, thus making myself a target for subsequent robocalls. As a result, I now never, ever answer questions on the telephone. Not surveys, not questionnaires about my household purchases or how many children live in my household. Not even calls from candidates in my own ward who are running for municipal elections, who are my neighbors, because they may not be who they say they are. I am weary of putting an election sign on my lawn, even though I recognize it's an important message to share and to promote the parties that I do believe in, who are working hard to make this community, this province, and this country a better place. Many people have scoffed at me or others who would actually believe these robocalls, who would have changed their destination. Me, I did. That's my naivety. It never occurred to me that someone would try to steal my vote, or that the integrity of the entire election system and structure was in jeopardy.
Who received a vote, and first thing in the morning with my husband and came back to find that indeed we had received a call as well. My husband is John Lawson, who was running for the Green Party at that time. And so I called him at his campaign office and said, you know, had you heard about anything like this? And he said, no, it's a lie. And we've already heard from Frank Blair's office that they've been, you know, their folks have been getting calls too. So I immediately called Elections Canada. The person who I spoke with really couldn't help me. So I asked immediately to speak to her supervisor, who assured me she would take down all the information, and I said, and I want a response. Then within a day or two, I received a call from Alan Matthews, who ended up being the chief investigator for the robocalls, and he came to Guelph and interviewed me and took an official statement. I asked him when we could expect to hear back from him, and he said, oh, this will take a while. Then the following February, I received a call from the Ottawa Citizen. They had found out about the investigation, and so I was interviewed by them. The story broke, and the next thing I knew, I was fielding calls from all the major news outlets. And although I am clergy and I'm comfortable speaking in front of people, unlike my husband, I like to fly under the radar in terms of politics. So this was a big stretch for me. But the reason I answered those phone calls and the reason I agreed to go on national television in spite of my fears that I would be misquoted or misrepresented was because I really firmly believe in the importance of standing up for our democracy and making sure that the kinds of things that we used to just read in the papers from the United States, and now we read about them in Canada, don't continue to happen here. And so this summer, I received a letter from Alan Matthews again, inviting me to make a victim impact statement in advance of the trial for Michael Sona. I again decided, yes, I will put myself out there and make a response, which I did. So that's my story, and I stand before you today really pleased to see the response of so many of you who also share these same feelings. Thank you. And she gave it to the elections officer. I did not receive a call or an investigation. That bothered me a little bit, but so many people have been interviewed, and I know that this is not the end of this event. It's going to happen again, and I really appreciate Kelly's impact statement that she gave to us today, because I've had similar feelings that when I see a phone number that I don't recognize, I will not answer my phone. So that's not a good thing either. That's impeding my freedom. So I do hope that out of this, that Elections Canada will give us some kind of a guideline if something like this happens again. So
so that we can make sure that they are getting all the exact information in good time. Thank you for listening.
Someone to speak about what's locally happening in Guelph. And as we listen to the conversations today, what can we do as individuals? What can we do to make a change to make sure this doesn't happen again? The Council of Canadians has called upon the Commissioner of Canada Elections to reopen the investigation. We feel this is widespread election fraud that took place in 2011. It's clear. The prosecutor and the judge in the Sona case has made it clear that he did not act alone. There were others behind this effort to subvert the last election. The Commissioner of Elections has a responsibility to reopen the investigation to find out what happened. So, in the opinion of the Executive Director, Gary Neal, the Council of Canadians, either the Conservative Party senior leaders were directly involved in the election fraud, or they were astoundingly negligent in securing access to their voter database. So the Council of Canadians continues to work on this. We are working on this in a number of ways. One of the ways we've done this is we were part of the trial to overturn six of the election results. So this is a matter that went before federal court, and despite the efforts of the Conservative Party lawyers to have the case thrown out, and to drive up the cost of hearing this case, there was a finding and it was found in our favor. The Council of Canadians has been supporting this. The costs are well into the hundreds of thousands of dollars. And as local members, we ask that you support this. There's an online campaign to provide money to support this legal challenge that took place. One of the key areas the Council of Canadians has been working on is to overturn the quote-unquote Fair Elections Act. After the 2011 election, the Conservative Party put into place legislation that would effectively gut the power of Elections Canada. There's been a charter challenge launched by the Council of Canadians. We're challenging this Elections Act. We're asking it to be overturned, and that two provisions, the ban on the use of voter information cards to provide residency and the muzzling of the chief electoral officer, both be changed. These are rights that are guaranteed under Section 3 of the Charter of Rights and Freedoms. This is something that's going forward. By supporting the local Council of Canadians, you're supporting this effort. And finally, the last thing we're asking people to get out and vote. Many people that I talk to say, there's nothing I can do to have an impact. Did you know in the 2011 election, there were 12 ridings. The difference in the vote between the Conservatives and the other party was 804 people that voted. Over 9.4 million people in Canada didn't vote in the last election. We're asking people to take the voter's challenge for this upcoming federal election. We're asking people to get out and to vote. We're asking them to challenge two of their friends to get out and vote. In the 2011 election, those 804 votes, it was the difference between a Conservative majority and a Conservative minority. Think about the difference that would have been in the last 4 years if we had a Conservative minority, or even a coalition of the NDP and the Liberal Party, so the Conservative Party in power in Ottawa. Join us. We have a table downstairs. We would love to speak to people. We'll talk about what kind of grassroots reactions we can take here in Guelph. Thank you for your time today.
Bobby Stewart. I was the NDP candidate in the 2011 campaign. I had that great honor here in Guelph. Okay, so you can see me as well. Okay. So I want to give a little bit of history about some things that happened before the election that sort of speaks to the tone and how things seem to heat up and get not quite so pleasant. I had a call from Ken Morgan, the manager of the Conservative campaign before the election. He invited me to have coffee with him. So I said, sure, I'd be delighted. I asked our NDP president, Cecilia Wazeres, to join me. And Marty Burke also joined me. Now, keeping in mind, I had met Ken campaigns before this, most particularly in the 2006 campaign when I worked for Phil Ault. And one of the things that I said to Ken at St. James High School during one of the debates at one of the volunteer tables was, you know, we have different politics. Sure we do. We have our partisan politics. But we have a lot in common because as volunteers, we care about democracy and we care enough to get involved. So isn't that kind of neat? We're different politically, but we have a lot in common. And I liked him. So we had coffee. It went very, very well. And the reason for the coffee, as Ken stated, was, look, the campaign is coming. It could heat up. Our policies are different. We just want to know it's not personal. We're all people working together. So that was great. At the all-candidates debate at St. James High School, it was interesting. After the debate, and after I had made a comment about Mr. Harper and that perhaps I didn't trust him or his policies, Mr. Morgan made a comment to my husband, Cameron Adams, who's in the audience here, who was our campaign manager, saying, "What's with your wife?" In other words, he seemed surprised that I would say something negative about his party or his leader. So we just thought that was rather unusual. So when EJ came along, what had happened is Harry Lane, our office manager, did start to get calls. There were at least six calls that came in. Our focus right then was, oh dear, we need to help these voters. Voters had been told that they were not supposed to vote at a particular location in the South End, but they were to vote in the old Quebec Street Mall. So our focus right then was to support the people that called and to work, and we worked with the Liberals, and with John Lawson, the Green Party offices as well, just to ask what did they know what was going on, and let's all work together and make sure that we can get people, drive people to the polls to preserve our democracy. So that was how we handled it. Now, initially, Harry tells me, they thought it was a hoax, like what's going on? And then of course it grew and it grew and it grew. So after E-Day, we of course got a call from the people that broke the scandal, and a gentleman called, I spoke to him, my husband Cameron spoke. We were quoted in the Globe and Mail. I told a little story about my past relationship with Mr. Morgan and the Conservatives and that it was positive. When Vic Kirsch called me before I came here, Vic asked me, did you have any idea what was going on? Did you think this would happen? And my comment was, E-Day, we were having a wonderful time. It was the election. We were in the office. I didn't think too much about it other than it was a hoax initially. I was too busy being a candidate and thinking about other things. But then after having said that and then watching the campaign heat up somewhat, I was very, very, very saddened. I mean, my first response was just to be very sad and very disappointed for all of us and for our democracy and for the individuals who were involved in this. So I want to thank Fair Vote Coalition for Social Justice, Council of Canadians for setting up this meeting. I'm thrilled that you've set it up. I'm really, really excited about the great work that you're all doing and that we are pursuing this. And it's not over yet. Thank you.
John Lawson, and I was the candidate for the Green Party in the last election. My wife, Sue Campbell, has already told the family side of things, how that unfolded. I guess what I was wanting to think about a little bit, and I thought about for a long time since this election, is the culture of a campaign that knowingly wants to deceive. And that's the thing that's been most disturbing. You know, as a candidate, and Bobby would say the same thing, you know, ultimately, things happen. People get excited in elections. They're acutely emotional events. And so every day there's some response that's needed. And I know that would be the same for me. You know, people would come and say, oh, I think we need to go hard on this one. And I say, well, let's think about it. I'm thinking about what the Conservative, and I have to name it. It was the Conservative Party culture in Guelph. Michael Sona, prior to election day, and an advanced poll at the University of Guelph, disrupted that polling station. went in and disrupted that polling station. And what kind of cultural response or reining in did either the candidate or the party do? Stonewalled and objected. And we see the same culture. I mean, Michael Sloan's a young kid. How many of us, when we were in our 20s, did stupid things? What kind of culture allows that to happen? And that's my concern. What kind of culture allows that to happen? Cynically attacking our democracy and cynically attacking anyone who doesn't happen to agree with it. Very troubling and very scary for our democracy. You know, these lists that we all now live with, I mean, we live with them, God knows how many of them, and many we don't know anything about. I mean, the Green Party, I was talking to our Green Party leader from Ontario, Schreiner. Mike was telling me that he was campaigning in Sudbury in a by-election this weekend. He has, leader of the party, had to sign a confidentiality agreement when he took those voters' lists and went knocking door to door. That culture says we protect and honor all citizens. And so I guess my feeling is that this is an important gathering here today where we say and stand up and say we need protection. We need motions in Parliament. We need an Elections Canada that has two teeth. And we need to take out, to be honest, a government that is very cynical in wanting to close down democracy in this country.
Been misdirected as to where to vote. Last Thursday, Ms. Boudreau phoned me to say that she could not come, as she had had a call from a lawyer in Ottawa telling her that her position as returning officer precluded any involvement in politics. I assured her that we only expected her to read her victim's impact statement, which was, of course, already public information from the trial, nothing more. Ms. Boudreau still declined to come, very politely, but firmly. Thank you.
So they also violated those CRTC rules. And my question is, why were no sanctions ever imposed by the CRTC against them? So I have 5 minutes to talk about a 5-day trial. And I told John Dennis, one of the event organizers, that felt to me like the challenge of the Toronto Theatre production of Potted Potter. $7 in 90 minutes. And so because I can't possibly begin to communicate the breadth of the sordid details of this crime in the time allotted, what I want to start by doing is to point you to some source documents where you yourself can directly read about the key content and the conclusions of the Sona trial. So the Canadian Legal Information Institute, you can also Google search it as CanLe, has a website on which legal rulings are posted. And if you go to that website and just enter Sona as a search term, it'll bring up Justice Hearn's rulings for Michael Sona's conviction and for his sentencing. Justice Hearn's decision on Michael Sona's finding of guilt runs to almost 50 pages. And in that ruling, he summarizes the relevant technical evidence as well as the testimony of all of the witnesses. So if you couldn't be at the trial along with Liz and I, reading the legal ruling is the next best thing to being there. And I think that you will learn a number of details that you may never have encountered in the mainstream media. The second decision of Justice Hearn on the website relates to the sentencing of Mr. Sona, and it also makes for compelling reading in terms of reference to the victim impact statements and the seriousness of the crime. And while you're on the CanLe website, I'd encourage you to look up the legal decision that John referred to of Justice Mosley, that's M-O-S-L-E-Y, and the case is McEwing versus Canada. And that's the legal ruling of the Council of Canadians case to have the election results overturned in 6 ridings, where Justice Mosley ruled that fraudulent calls occurred in those 6 ridings and that he was satisfied that the source of those phone numbers was the Conservative database accessed by persons unknown to the court. That will help to give you a bigger picture. I would also highly recommend a new book out by journalist Michael Harris, Party One, which features Susan Campbell, and it devotes several chapters to the 2011 voter suppression and the Sona trial. So those are some places where you can go directly to read for yourself about what happened at the trial. So for me, what was really shocking in the admitted facts, which covered the technical evidence, was the level of premeditation, coordination, sophistication, and criminality. I read observations from others that burner cell phones and cash-loaded Visa gift cards are normally things you find in the toolkit of organized crime. I really came out of the trial with many more questions than I had going in. Clearly, Elections Canada did not have the resources or the powers to properly investigate this trial and bring all those involved to justice. And so what I would like to see going forward is renewed calls for a full judicial inquiry into the national scope of this voter suppression with a judge who has the power to subpoena witnesses and compel testimony under oath. And I think a federal election is the perfect time to demand that commitment of all candidates. There were a number of shockers and twists and turns in the trial, and it wasn't until the closing arguments that the Crown prosecutor pulled an ace out of his sleeve. Reading Michael Harris's book, apparently Michael Sona's lawyer, Norm Boxall, didn't believe the Crown had enough evidence to convict Mr. Sona. So Mr. Sona never took the stand himself, nor did he call his own witnesses. But here's the ace that Mr. Michelson pulled out of his sleeve. The Crown drew the judge's attention to two elements in the technical evidence which have exactly the same time and date stamp. Someone was in the Conservative campaign office at a computer uploading phone lists to the RAC9 server at exactly the same time and date as another individual was buying a cash-loaded Visa gift card at a Shoppers Drug Mart. Both actions could not have been carried out by the same person. The option this presented to the judge was that he didn't have to find that Michael Sona was the sole architect and agent of the crime. He could find that Michael Sona was a party to the offense, and that's exactly what happened. So the involvement of others in this crime is not just a suggestion or supposition. It's established by the technical evidence. Personally, it burns me that Michael Sona is still claiming innocence and that he knows nothing about what happened. For Michael Sona not to know anything would mean that all four interns who testified Sona boasted to them about his involvement after the fact, Rebecca Dockstetter, John Shudlow, Mitchell Messam, and Benjamin Hicks, would have to be lying under oath. It's clear that there was some very inappropriate involvement in the investigation behind the scenes by the Conservative Party, but I don't think that translated into these people lying on the stand. That's my 5 minutes, and I'll be happy to do my best to answer any questions you may have during the Q&A. Thank you. Transcripts of court testimony, there is a process to request them at a cost of $6 a page, I think it was. So it is possible that a transcript could have been requested that we didn't think that we could obtain it within a 3-day window.
That's absolutely right. We couldn't do anything. And you have to wonder about the timing of Thursday night. We only had one day to try to get it, and I don't know whether was intentional or not, or on whose part it was, but I did try, and I think it's a complicated procedure, which I will persevere with.
Yes.
I've been working on issues of electoral fraud as a kind of perverse hobby, one might say, for over a decade. I'm a professor of English literature, but I'm interested in deceptions of all kinds, whether in fiction or in the world of politics. And I've been publishing, and again publishing on American presidential elections immediately after the 2004 election, which was marked by scandalous levels of fraud, and indeed falls into easily into the category of a stolen election. There's massive evidence to show that. Now, what I think I would like to do as expeditiously as possible for you is to run through what I think some of the key information is that you can take into your reflections on the upcoming 2015 election. I'd like first to supplement the very helpful information that, that Susan Watson gave us. There is an additional resource that I would recommend to you, which you can access at www.thescriptfilmco.com. This is a documentary film in progress being made by the Ottawa documentary filmmaker Peter Smaczynski. And you can see at that website samples of the interviews that he has already done. And you'll also see a request for assistance with crowdfunding. At the moment, I think he's traveling to the West Coast to raise money for his film. He'll be speaking to large audiences in Victoria and elsewhere. If you're impressed by what you see, I would urge you to think about supporting that project. Now, the big picture, let's consider first some numbers. How many fraudulent telephone calls were there in Canada? Nobody can say with any degree of precision, but we do have evidence from three useful sources. There are polls that were conducted in early 2012 by two highly respected polling companies, Ipsos Reid and ECOS Research, and there are the, to my mind, thoroughly inadequate, but nonetheless useful, records of complaints that Elections Canada kept. They only began to get serious about complaints some months after the election, by the way, so their records are by no means accurate. What these three sources can tell us is the following. There were, as everyone knows, but it's very easy to forget, there were two kinds of fraudulent vote suppression calls during the 2011 election. There were harassment phone calls that began, in some writings, at the very beginning of the election campaign, March 26th. Eglinton Lawrence, there were reports of harassment calls coming in from the very beginning and right through the election. Some of you may have received these calls because they were reported from Guelph. These were calls, you might receive automated calls at 2 in the morning saying, will you please support your Liberal candidate, sometimes in a tinny mechanical voice. Almost designed to annoy. If you slammed the phone down, it might ring again 10 minutes later and wake you up again with the same request. Or it could be a live operator phone call that might have come into your home on Easter Sunday. Or if you're Jewish, perhaps in the middle of the Pesach dinner, you'd be interrupted just as somebody is reading the four questions, the answer to which is, of course, why is this night different from all other nights? And the telephone would ring to the fifth question, saying, this is your Liberal candidate, will you please, blah, blah, blah. Which is, of course, designed to aggravate people. Surprisingly, according to Elections Canada data, 51% of the total complaints received were about harassment calls. 49% were about misinformation calls, which began to come in on April 29th. First, live operator calls, and then, on the day before the election and election day, massively robocalls, which were, as everybody knows, the calls that sent people to non-existent or to incorrect polling stations, invariably further away from than their actual polling stations were. Now, the data from the two pollsters, Ipsos Reid and ECOS Research, give us information only about the misinformation calls. Ipsos Reid found that 4% of Canadians have received such calls. ECOS, who's had a larger sample size and was, I think, more reliable, came up with a number of 2.3%. Ipsos, I think, went astray because their sample was very largely an Ontario sample. And I believe that what their data shows us is that the misinformation fraud was indeed concentrated very largely in Ontario ridings. What they did was to extrapolate their Ontario data nationally, and I think that led them astray a little bit. Okay, in round numbers then, those figures, the ECOS research figures, which I take to be the more reliable, tell us that there were something like 550,000 fraudulent misinformation calls received by Canadian voters in the last days of the 2011 election. If we add to that the complaints data from Elections Canada, we get an aggregate number of substantially more than 1.1 million fraudulent calls across Canada during that election. 1.1 million vote suppression calls, which of course did not go out randomly. 261 ridings are recorded as having sent complaints in to, or people from 261 ridings complained to Elections Canada. In many of those ridings, the calls appear to have been scattered, possibly occurring only in several polling districts. We really don't know. There are at least two dozen ridings which were seriously bombarded by thousands of fraudulent calls. So there you have some numbers. By the way, the question always arises, how effective are robocalls? Well, robocalls are not going to work in any subsequent election in this country, because we know about them. But in 2008, in the riding of Sandwich Gulf Islands, there was a kind of laboratory test of what robocalls can do. When shortly before election day, the NDP candidate was obliged to withdraw from the race due to a kind of silly scandal involving stupid behavior from 12 years before. His name remained on the ballot papers. Now, a poll taken in that riding indicated that whereas in the previous election, the NDP had received 26 point something percent of the vote in Sandwich Gulf Islands, that was in 2006, a day or two before the 2008 election, less than 1% of people intended to vote for the NDP. In other words, fewer than 1% of voters didn't know, hadn't been following the news, didn't know that there was no NDP candidate still in the race. Now, on the day before the election, the riding was bombarded with robocalls which purported to come from the NDP campaign office, saying, get out and support Julian West, our candidate. He's a great guy. We really want him in representing us in Ottawa, et cetera, et cetera. With the result that 5.7% of the electorate in Sandwich Gulf Islands voted NDP. In other words, 4.7% of the people in that riding were deceived by the robocall into throwing their votes down the drain. So there are some numbers for you. The estimates, by the way, of the impact, the kind of percentage impact of the robocalls in 2011 come to us from two sources. One is ECOS Research, whose estimate is that there was a vote suppression effect of on average, 1.5% in the seven subject ridings that they studied for the Council of Canadians supported law case. 1.5% doesn't sound like much, but if you remember that these were ridings, most of which had a very close race, and that the range of vote suppression effects that ECOS recorded was actually between 1.2 and 1.8%, with a margin of error in both directions beyond those numbers. That is more than sufficient to have altered the results in, by my estimate, four of the six ridings that were ruled on by Judge Richard Mosley. An economist from Simon Fraser University did a study in early 2012. Anka Kessler is her name, which used a completely different range of methodologies, very sophisticated statistical work, focusing on two dozen ridings in which the reports, according to Elections Canada information, of misinformation robocalls were most intense. She found a 2% vote suppression effect, which amounted in those ridings, on average, to something like 2,000 votes per riding. Now, this is, of course, not material that one can say proves anything beyond doubt, but it does suggest very strongly that there's not merely a significant ethical issue involved here as to how anyone can trust the organization responsible for this fraud in the future, But there's also a serious question as to whether the government that now holds a majority as a result of the 2011 election won that majority through fraud. There's the evidence, by the way, as I'm sure you are aware, points very strongly, all the available evidence, to that guilty organization being the Conservative Party of Canada. The evidence includes internal Elections Canada emails, Elections Canada officials who were receiving the early reports of fraudulent phone calls in the days before the election, fraudulent misinformation calls, which came with callback numbers that in many cases led, not as one of our fellow citizens has said, to numbers in the United States or in faraway places, but led to Conservative Party campaign office lines, towards the commission was directed. There's a great deal more information, which I think I'll just pass over for the moment. Perhaps it can come up in question period. Information leading to the conclusion that the Conservative Party was the organizing agency. Now, I think one important matter to understand, in Guelph in particular, is how seriously we were let down by the investigation of this crime. We were let down across Canada by the fact that the only riding in which there was anything resembling a serious investigation was in fact Guelph. But we were also let down in Guelph itself. And let me explain why. What we know about, from court documents, from newspapers and so on, are the so-called Jeffoutin calls. Jeffoutin, alias Pierre Jones, who organized a burst of robocalls that went out between 10:03 and 10:14 on the morning of May the 2nd to something like 6,500 Guelph residents, giving them misinformation about their proper polling station. Now that is the only set of fraudulent calls that were investigated in Guelph. Elections Canada, or the Elections Canada investigator working in Guelph, also had very clear indications, very clear evidence, that there were other calls in addition to those fraudulent calls. How do we know this? Because as soon as the Elections Canada office opened at 9:10 on May the 2nd, it was flooded with complaints from Guelph residents. This is more than an hour before the Jeffoutin calls went out. At 9:30, when the old Quebec Street Mall polling stations were opened, the Elections Canada official responsible for that polling station reported that people began immediately showing up who had been deluded by fraudulent phone calls and sent to the wrong polling station. We also know, and again the Elections Canada investigator knew, that there were calls in the afternoon. These were in fact mentioned in the Guelph Mercury on May the 2nd, 2011, in which people were informed, I'm awfully sorry, but polling stations are closed early. So don't bother voting. If you look at the court documents, the information to obtain documents filed by the Elections Canada investigator, Alan Matthews, you discover that he only asked for information about calls sent out from the Edmonton voice broadcaster Rackline on May the 2nd, or calls that were linked directly to Conservative Party officials. In other words, any surreptitious calls that went out from Rackline as part of the fraud earlier than May 2nd, he received no information about, and we therefore know effectively nothing about them as well. How many of the complainants in Guelph were contacted by Elections Canada? 379 complaints were recorded in Guelph. 18 people were contacted. None of the people on the second list sent to Alan Matthews by the Liberal Party. Only 5 people on the first list of 79 people that were sent by Frank Valeriote's office to Al Matthews. The Green Party and the NDP indicated to Elections Canada that they also had lists. They were not contacted, at least according to the court documents, perhaps I can be corrected on this. They were not contacted for information as to who those people were. The investigation also made some very significant errors. One of them, it was quite crucial, I think, in terms of the reporting of the fraud, resulted from the fact that the investigator was unaware that Rogers is in the habit of recycling his modems. So he was able to track fraudulent calls to the modem that, from which they'd been sent, which was in a house somewhere to the southwest of Guelph. The true perversity of it is this, that the technical evidence available, and available to anyone who reads the Elections Canada court documents, the information to obtain documents filed by Alan Matthews, that information points unambiguously in the direction of the assistant manager of the Conservative Party campaign, Andrew Prescott. The evidence shows that and this is evidence from session logs from the RAC 9 voice broadcaster, that he and the person who organized the roll calls, let's say Campbell, were either very closely acquainted or else one and the same person. Prescott and Pierre Jones used the same two internet protocol addresses. Pierre Jones logged into two of Prescott's voice broadcaster sessions. Prescott stored three sessions under the name of Pierre Jones, and on two occasions on election day, Jones and Prescott, these are the RAC 9 names are client 45, that's Prescott, and client number 93, Pierre Jones. Jones and Prescott logged in within minutes of each other from the same IP address. Now, I would suggest that in an uncorrupted investigation, this information would have justified the laying of charges against Prescott, or at the very least, it would have justified treating him as a person of interest, of very great interest, of intense interest, instead of which he was granted immunity from prosecution. I mentioned the trial as having an element of farce. There was one issue on which the judge and the Crown attorney and Michael Sona's attorney agreed on, which was that the testimony of Andrew Prescott was utterly unreliable. That was filled with prevarications, inventions, reformulations, sudden convenient recall of purported facts that had not been mentioned at any point previously to Elections Canada investigators on D2A. I'll give you another frustrating detail indicating the deficiencies of the investigation, not just in Guelph, but elsewhere. You may recall from early 2012, there was electrifying news from Thunder Bay. A very courageous woman who had worked as a call center operator for the call center that was sending out many of the live operator calls on behalf of the Conservative Party, was all over the media because she had, during the election, gone to her supervisor and then to the RCMP and to Elections Canada to say that she and her co-workers believed strongly that what they were being asked to do by their employer was unethical and illegal. That in effect they were providing people with misleading information about their voting places. Now, when Annette Desgagnés' evidence came forward, there were, of course, reports throughout the national news media, which were followed a couple of days later by reports in the Toronto Star and CBC News, to the effect that the Conservative Party was sending senior officials to Thunder Bay to go through the call center's audio records and files. Now, that report was promptly denied by a Conservative Party lawyer named Fred DeLaurie, who unfortunately on other occasions has denied reports and turned out to have been dealing with what he had to admit was false information. So his denial, I think, is to my mind at least, suspect. There is no innocent explanation for senior party officials being dispatched to go through those files. Because if you knew that there was nothing illegal about the robocalls that you had been sending out, there would be no possible reason to go through the files. You can anticipate that there would be some cases in which the information your operators provided to voters was correct, while the elections candidate information on their voter information cards was wrong, and there would be others in which the voters have the right information and the information you provided them was incorrect. That would be statistical noise. These would more or less cancel each other out. Why bother? Here's the kicker, though. Elections Canada announced that it was also going to send one of its experienced investigators to Thunder Bay to look into this matter. He would be there, they said, next week. The front door, when he arrived, I'm quite sure was wide open, and there was nothing there, and the footprints had been erased. Now, finally, I just want to mention the document that came out was released by the Commissioner of Canada Elections in April of last year, announcing this was the summary investigation report on robocalls. The Commissioner of Canada Elections is Yves Côté. He's the man responsible for enforcing the Canada Elections Act. In this report, he announced that the investigation was being closed down. This is an investigation in Canada apart from Guelph. It was closed down because they did not find evidence of intention. In other words, his judgment, and he claimed the judgment of his investigator, was that apart from Guelph, what had happened was merely kind of error, perhaps frivolous, mischievous behavior, but they did not find evidence. Now let's go back for a moment to the complaints data published in that same report. There were 2,448 complaints reported by Elections Canada. 51% of them complaints about harassment, 49% of them complaints about misinformation. It's a surprising figure. There were only 1,726 complainants. There was no analysis of this difference in the report. But think about it for a moment. 2,448 complaints, 1,726 complainants. People complaining about two distinct kinds of fraudulent calls. What does this tell us? It tells us that 42% of the complainants were complaining about having received both kinds of calls. Now, you don't have to be a statistician. I run this figure past statistician colleagues whose jaws drop. You don't have to be a statistician to realize that this is clear evidence of a linkage between the two kinds of calls and clear evidence of targeting and intention. One last point about the summary investigation report on robocalls. If you look at its executive summary, the first two statements in the executive summary are both either false or misleading. The Commissioner of Canada Elections tells us that his predecessor, William Corbett, who was Commissioner at the time of the election, received approximately 100 complaints about nuisance phone calls or calls providing voters with incorrect poll location information during the election. We know that is not correct. We know that in Guelph alone, in the space of about an hour, in the morning of May the 2nd, 2011, the Elections Canada office received more than 100 calls and was unable to answer something like a third more than that number. So that's the very first paragraph of the executive summary. So the second piece of information, we're informed that Elections Canada returning officers dealt with complaints about incorrect poll location calls that began to come in on April 29th, that's several days before the election, quote, as errors. This is simply not true. We have the internal emails of Elections Canada officials. They're public documents now. And they were not saying this is a matter of randomness or errors or mistakes or something. They were saying the Conservative Party appears to be doing this. And on April 29th and May 1st, they contacted the Conservative Party's lawyer, Dr. Hamilton, to say, here's what's going on. Can something be done? So, to sum up then, we have a very serious problem in front of us in the form of a corrupt climate of behavior within one of our leading political organizations in this country. We have what appears to be a secondary problem of a climate of, it might be intellectual corruption I'm not quite sure what to call it, but a climate of inadequacy, investigative inadequacy, in the agencies that ought to be looking into criminality of this kind. I haven't mentioned the RCMP, but there's lots one can say about them as well, and Elections Canada. And there's an additional problem with the media, because we've had excellent reporting from a small number of reporters. Michael Harris's book, Party of One, Sue Watson recommended. I recommend it to you very strongly if you want to get a sense of what it is we're up against. Stephen Mather, John McGregor, Lawrence Martin of Global Mail, Alfie Raj, Roy Payton of CBC. But you don't need the fingers of more than one hand, really, to total the journalists who've done outstanding work on this issue. So finally, what do we do? I think one of the things we need to do is organize ourselves to have a massive increase in voter turnout in the next election. If you think of the example of the United States, the elections, the presidential elections of 2000 and 2004 were stolen. The presidential election of 2008 featured all the same kinds of fraud that the previous ones had featured, but the increase in Democratic Party turnout was sufficient to overwhelm that effect. Same thing in 2009. You can avoid, I think one of the tactics that's going to be used, and I'll save that for questions actually. We do know something about what to anticipate, and we can think about what to do about it. But I'll stop now.
Address this and bring in proportional representation. BC, our democratic system is broken. The fraudulent robocalls is a sign of a system of an electoral system that really is just on life support. The majority of Canadians do not experience the Canadian government to be their government. And this is an accurate perception, as only about 23%, or 6 million, of the 24 million people who voted, or who were on the voters list, the 2011 voters list, actually voted for our current government. That's less than 1 in 4 people that are actually being heard or their voices represented in Ottawa. There are many more votes wasted than votes that have a voice in government. Our democratic system is broken. It's broken, it's unfair, and it systematically silences the less fortunate. Our system is delivering phony election results, and Canadians know it. Canada has had 16 majority governments since 1921, and 12 of those majorities have been false majorities. The first past the post electoral system might also be called the wealthy white male electoral system. About 800 years ago, wealthy businessmen in England were tired of having the king take their money and send their sons to die in war. These wealthy businessmen were smart talkers, and the first past the post system was a good way for them to maintain their power and their wealth. And thus, the wealthy white male electoral system was created. This first past the post system was never designed to include the voices of women, young people, First Nations people, minorities, and people living in poverty. Women continue to make up only 25% of the MPs in our first past the post parliament, while 45% of the MPs in Sweden's PR democracy are women. Canada, Britain, and the USA are the only developed nations that continue with first past the post. All other developed nations have moderately proportional representation systems. 10 different citizens' assemblies or royal commissions in Canada have now recommended PR for Canada. Fair Vote is dedicated to more fair election outcomes. Due to how first past the post splits and then wastes our votes, a government will likely have a minority mandate if they get 38% or less of votes cast. If a party can get 40% of the votes, then they are almost assured of 100% of the power. 40% has never been a passing grade in school, so how can it deliver 100% of the political power in our great country? Looking more closely, there are only 6,700 votes in a number of swing ridings that provided the mandate for our current government. We can expect more distorted results from our current first past the post system. And our system rewards the worst kinds of behaviors, and fraudulent robocalls are just one of these behaviors. Robocalls are one approach to voter suppression, or intentionally reducing voter turnout. Adversarial and toxic behavior causes ordinary people to tune politics out, because a 2% swing in votes can mean 100% power. We can expect more attack ads, more misinformation, and more smear campaigns, and more robocalls. Here's some other behaviors we can expect in the 2015 election. Campaign money will be raised in one region and strategically spent to influence an election unfairly. Money is spent to gather data and then amplify divisive issues that will polarize communities. Jennifer Stoddard, Canada's Privacy Commissioner, points out how the first-past-the-post system drives parties to gather and analyze very detailed data on electors. And I'll quote from her. This is on the Government of Canada website. Parties believe they need ever more precise information on voter behavior and intentions, so that they might target more precisely defined segments of an electorate in key competitive ridings. So, first past the post causes political parties to pry into our lives and to target us individually at home and on the internet. Divisive issues are then amplified to secure a segment of votes. An example of this might be saber-rattling or amplifying security risks in Canada. There are often very unfortunate consequences for Canada in the eyes of the rest of the world, as our diplomats, our peacekeepers, and our UN partners are undermined, and money is used to polarize issues rather than to find and support peace. Polling data can also identify safe seats where a party can essentially ignore the people in that area and the party still be assured to win. So think, lower voter turnout and apathy. Some Canadians are ignored and other Canadians receive extra attention and big government spending announcements. Does anyone remember a recent government spending announcement in Guelph? Yes, we are a swing riding. I want to speak specifically to poverty and democracy. On election day, all Canadians should be equal. The will of the people is being distorted by the flaws in our first-past-the-post system, and the value of a vote is systematically being taken from the poor. No wonder we have low voter turnout. Now, I can say one good thing about the first-past-the-post system. It is simple. Whoever gets the most votes in a relatively small geographic area wins. And, win or lose, a voter can typically walk or ride their horse to their elected official's office to petition their representative. Yes, 800 years ago, people had those two options to communicate with their representative. PR is really pretty simple too. If a party gets 30% of the votes, then it should get 30% of the seats in Parliament. True, your representative may not live in your town, but fortunately, now we have the telephone, the internet, email, Facebook, Twitter, airplanes, maybe even a car. One day, eventually, we'll have a great public transportation system in Canada. There are some preferred outcomes that modern democracies have achieved by embracing PR. PR systems yield more stable governments. Between 1945 and 1998, countries using first-past-the-post averaged more elections, in fact, averaged 16.7 elections, while countries using proportional systems averaged only 16 elections. On the economic side, the London School of Business reports that countries with PR were less likely to have deficits and more likely to have fiscal surpluses. Knudsen found that both proportional and semi-proportional systems produced higher economic growth than plurality majoritarian systems. Those are first-past-the-post systems. PR has better outcomes for the environment. One example is on carbon emissions. The percentage of the world carbon emissions has decreased in PR countries, while it's increased in other countries or remain static. Proportional democracies are just more democratic. Aaron Lippert researched 36 countries over a 56-year period and found that PR democracies are, or have, 7.5% higher voter turnout, and the government policies are closer to the mean voter view, and that citizens are more satisfied with democracy, and 8% more women were elected. So, where do Canadian political parties stand on PR today? The Conservatives did have a party resolution to support PR back in 2002. Unfortunately, Conservatives see first-past-the-post as serving their interests now, as it served the Liberals' interests under Jean Chrétien's false majorities. About the Liberals, PR is one of several electoral options the Liberals are currently considering. And I want to acknowledge leading Liberals, Stephan Dion, Joyce Murray, and our Frank Valeriote, who stood in support of an NDP motion in Parliament just before Christmas. Unfortunately, Justin Trudeau was not standing in support of PR. Mr. Trudeau favors another winner-take-all system called alternative vote. Sir Winston Churchill described alternative vote as being ruled by the hindmost, and I'll refer you to the Fair Vote website for more details on that topic. The NDP has a long tradition of supporting PR. Thomas McLaren promised in December to update Canada's electoral system to MMP, mixed member proportional electoral system. So thanks to the NDP for their solid commitment to PR. Likewise, the Greens and Elizabeth May are committed to PR. Ms. May completed a Save Democracy from Politics tour this last year. So, what can we do here in Guelph? The list went around, you can sign up to get on the email list, and we'll be sure to include different judicial efforts happening. Council of Canadians, they're actively engaged in that effort to bring forward justice, more justice on electoral fraud. The Declaration of Voters' Rights, that sheet is going around, and I really hope that you'll get on the email list so we can send you to our website and you can forward that around to all other Canadians. So far we've got 45,000 Canadians who have signed that petition for voter rights. We would really like you to join Fair Vote Canada. And yes, give us your money, make a donation. Fourth, we would like you to write a letter to the editor or to send a postcard to an MP. Particularly, Mr. Trudeau needs to hear from us. Lots of postcards to Mr. Trudeau. There's little cards in the back there that says fair or it's proportional representation on the one side. You just write on the other side a piece of paper, you know, fill in your details. Mr. Trudeau, I want fair democracy, and send it off to the fellow. You know where he works. Six. Or I'm not sure, five. I think it's four. The five. Meet with candidates who are seeking nomination. Participate in the 2015 election and make PR an issue. Six. It is an election year, so help organize an event. You can do one in your home, a postcard writing event. You can meet with candidates. Or help us with a public event. And please speak with Mr. Ken McKay, our fearless leader here in Guelph. Where are you, Ken? Ah, there he is. Now, we have several ideas on what we might do next. Maybe a little bit easier to stomach. There's a documentary called WIT, The Secret World of Party Discipline. That would, if people would like to see that, maybe raise your hand and come up for that. There, okay, some interest for that. There's also a suggestion of having a public discussion on do we need parties anyways? Would people want to talk about do we need parties anyways? Some interest in that, maybe not quite as much. There was another suggestion, a keynote address on political party database and privacy concerns. Who is the speaker, the author, Suzanne? Jennifer Stutter, okay. So we think we'd get a keynote speaker on that if that would be of interest. Political database. Okay, that'd be more hardcore stuff. But think about this stuff. Please reach out to us, find Ken or myself or one of these good people, and we'd love to engage Guelph and more Canadians in protecting democracy. So thank you so much for coming out today, and look forward to engaging with you.